Good morning, Facebook. I told you I had one more stop to make. And so, let's get with it.
707 Andrews Tower, you are cleared runway 27, wind 035 at...
A lot of you may have noticed I'm trying to spend a lot of time in Texas. It's because I love Texas. The reason for that is because Texas embodies a spirit that was the American spirit at one point. And we have had a tendency of losing that spirit over the years. It's getting more and more every day. But they honor their history, which is something that the rest of the U.S. says they do, but they don't. And here's what I mean. Recent events in Louisiana, where they're taking down the Confederate monuments and everything. If you take away or rewrite history, you don't learn anything from it, or you forget it. And if you forget it, you make the same mistakes again. And you need to remember those things. Because if you do them again, you're just setting yourself up for a repeat of history that you don't want. You can learn things from history of what you do need to do and how you need to handle things differently. But you can't ever forget your history. Today, this morning, we're at Fort Chadburn. Now, you've probably never heard of Fort Chadburn. But in the early 1850s, Texas was a fairly new state. And the settlers were moving west. And along the western line at the time was the line between Abilene and San Antonio. That line was pretty much the furthest west the settlers were at the time. And the Comanches and the Kiowa Indians were at first very welcoming to the white man as they were coming out. Because they weren't trying to take their property, okay? So they traded things. They traded for tobacco. They traded for alcohol. They traded for whatever. They helped the white man at first with trying to provide, such as showing them how to hunt and etc., the game that were in the area. But then the white man wanted to take their property and settle it. And the Kiowa and the Comanches were like, this is our home, not yours. So the Comanches and the Kiowas, they started using raiding parties on horseback. Now, if you want to talk about a cavalry soldier, best light cavalry soldier was the Comanche, hands down. He'd beat anything the U.S. Army had. They were mobile, they were fast, and they knew how to live off the land. Now, in this area, there are several, river basins, the Concho, the Colorado River Basin, and all through comes through here. And even though it's desert plains kind of thing, the West Texas plains, plain land, you know, grass, low-lying trees and bushes, water was still scarce. So the Comanches would camp in the river basins, okay? And then they'd send their raiding parties out. So in 1852, Fort Chadburn was established. It was one of several, I think like seven or eight forts along that western line between San Antonio and Abilene that would help ferret out those raiding parties. Let's take a quick look.
Thank you.
and I'm standing in the middle of the parade and training field. This is where all your cavalry soldiers would do their drills. This is where they would do artillery here. They had infantry and cavalry here. The infantry was first, and they actually built all the buildings. And you can tell, and I'll post some of the pictures, you can tell by the hue marks in the stones that they all did it with chisel, okay, hammer and chisel. They actually had a sawmill here on property that would make all the, cut all the timbers, including the roofing material, the little wooden shingles, okay? And everything that was used to build this fort came from this fort's property, okay? So, right here, that's the Central Men's Barracks, okay? And behind that, you have the stagecoach station that, at the time, any location where people would get on and off the stagecoach was dangerous unless it was at a fort, okay? So most of the time, the stagecoaches didn't stop along the way for water and that kind of thing at these river basins and all. They would just keep moving until they got to a fort and would resupply there, give the folks time enough to be able to get out, stretch, maybe spend the night, and then they'd move out again. This building here was what they called a double officer's quarters, okay? And that's where all your lieutenants, captains, and etc. would stay. Over here, those remains there are of the fort commanders. That's where the fort commander would live. It is under terrible, terrible disarray right now. And, sorry, I have to kind of watch where I'm walking here. Horse poop. And then over there is probably the most important building on the fort. And that's the Fort Hospital. That was the first building built here. And it was probably the most important because of the continued skirmishes between the soldiers here and the Indians. This building right here was the commander for the area, not just this fort, but that's for the whole 8th Army, okay? And that's a little bitty building. You would think that the commander for the 8th Army would have a huge house. Now, I'm going to post some pictures of that that's just around it, because it's very small, very small. And you would think that, you know, the commander of the 8th Army would have a bigger house. Wrong. So, bring you up a little bit further in time, the turning point in when things really got bad here was when a couple of Army mail carriers got attacked just off post here. When they found their bodies, they had been shot with arrows and then put on trees and burnt. And they took that real seriously. So they really started trying to ferret out these raiding parties and at the same time negotiate with the Indians. Now, when they tried to negotiate with the Indians, they had 40 Kiowa and Comanche, mostly Comanche, higher up chiefs and all, that came here for a meeting with the commander. And while they were here, they noticed that, and they took from them letters. And they were like, Comanche don't write letters, and they don't mail them. On a couple of the guys, they also found that hanging on their hips, they found the Colt revolvers that those two mail carriers would have carried with them. So the commander quietly notified the troops that were training here in the field that day that they were going to arrest all 40 of these the Comanche and Kiowa commanders, chiefs, and charge them with the murder of the two mail carriers. When they came into the room to arrest the Indians, all hell broke loose. A ton of the Indians were killed. One guy got away, but he ended up in the 8th Army commander's house. They kicked the door and they killed him. A couple of more actually made it out of the fort and alerted the remaining Comanches in the area. And it started an all-out war kind of thing between the U.S. Army and the Comanches. Which brings us to this point. The U.S. Army sent a new young lieutenant colonel to this base to rendezvous the 8th Army together here, the whole 8th Army, which consisted at the time of about 12,000 troopers, and told him to go out and round up 30,000 Indians. That lieutenant colonel was none other than Lieutenant Colonel United States Army, not Confederate Army, but United States Army, Robert E. Lee. And the house for the 8th Army commander was Robert E. Lee's last house, and this was his last command before he became the commanding general for the Confederate Army. The officers' quarters held majors, captains, and etc. that went by the name of Hood and Pickett and Johnston. Yeah, those are the same guys that were the generals for the Confederate Army. You might remember Pickett from Pickett's Charge, i.e. Gettysburg. If you could stand here right now with me, you would feel humbled. I've been in this military for 25 years, and I never, ever lose any kind of respect, be it North or South, for the armies of our American history. Chose to defend their states because they loved their states. They loved their states to the point where they were willing to separate the nation that they loved as well. And I think that's kind of the feel for Texas right now. Texas has the 7th largest economy in the world. Okay, 7th largest in the world. They could be their own country, but they love the United States as well. They always fly the American flag above the Texas flag. And as I've crossed Texas over the last couple of days, I could top a hill, look out over the trees for the lower lying areas. I would see another hill, the trees that covered it, and standing tall above those trees would be a United States of America flag, not a Texas flag, a U.S. flag. You gotta love it. Get off the internet. Get in your vehicle, get in on your motorcycle. Do whatever you gotta do. Do what my son wants to do. Paramotoring. Hang from a parachute with a motor behind it. Do whatever you gotta do. Get out. Go see your historical sites. This is on private property. In 1877, the Odoms bought this property from the United States government and made it a homestead. And for years and years and years, they lived off of it just like it was a home, not knowing what all significance this property had. So one of the children in the 1900s, late 1900s, as a matter of fact, because I was here 10 years ago and the museum wasn't even here, had gone to college and realized, studying history, that he lived and he had American history in his backyard. He came home. He started a foundation, and they started excavating this property. At this point, they have a museum out front, which is an excellent museum. Excellent museum. They have found over 500,000 artifacts from this property alone. 500,000. They have excavated all this, and now they're taking that foundation out to other forts in the area and doing excavations there to find other historical artifacts from those areas. And in great Texas tradition, they're doing it all without any federal money. Most of it, actually, is coming from donations at the door. If that's not American, I don't know what is. Screw getting the federal government to pay for anything that you can do yourself. Quit looking for handouts. Do it yourself. This is Andy Crutchfield with the last video blog for this trip. And I wanted to leave you with this one, because it's probably the best of all. Keep looking up, because that's where it all is.
Runway 27, wind 035 at